WCBI News at 10 starts now.
Developing tonight, a man is in the Clay County Jail after his alleged involvement in a Saturday afternoon shooting. Sheriff Eddie Scott says the shooting happened around 5 p.m. near a residence on Happy Hollow Road, close to the Chickasaw County line. Two gunshot victims were transported to the hospital in West Point. A third gunshot victim was sent to a hospital in Tupelo. Sheriff says a female was also assaulted during the shooting. Officers believe she was hit in the stomach. No names have been released in regards to the suspect or the victims, and no charges have been filed at this time. This is an ongoing investigation. If you have any information, please contact the Clay County Sheriff's Department. We're going to have more information as it becomes available. The Mississippi Department of Health reports 288 new cases of COVID-19 with 12 new deaths. The total number of cases is now more than 9,300 with 421 deaths since March 11th. Analysts say the numbers continue to climb, in part because testing is becoming more common. And more than 90,000 tests have been performed by state and private providers. Regionally, Monroe County still sets the pace by hitting the 200 confirmed case mark. The health department releases the number of recoveries weekly, with the new set due on Monday. The May 3rd recovered figure has more than 4,400 in Mississippi. Well, globally, the number of coronavirus cases has passed the 4 million mark. About one-third of the more than 77,000 reported U.S. coronavirus deaths have happened in New York State. And now the governor is addressing a new ailment in children that may be related to the coronavirus. CBS News correspondent Danya Bacchus has the latest.
New York Governor Andrew Cuomo spoke about a mysterious illness that has now taken the lives of three children in the state.
Toddler elementary school children are presenting symptoms similar to Kawasaki disease or toxic shock-like syndrome.
Cuomo says the ailment affects children's blood vessels and potentially the heart. It does not appear to attack the respiratory system. But the state health department is studying 73 cases in which children with the syndrome have COVID-19 antibodies or test positive for the coronavirus.
This is the last thing that we need at this time with all that's going on.
New York, the nation's hardest hit state, has not started easing stay-at-home restrictions. The rules are set to expire Friday, with plans to gradually reopen businesses in some areas. Open Up Kansas protesters rallied near the state house in Topeka Saturday.
Every job is essential.
Governor Laura Kelly's phased reopening plan took effect on Monday. In parts of western Pennsylvania, retail businesses opened their doors on Friday, giving shoppers a chance to support local businesses.
They know you by name, they know your style, they know, so, I mean, it's important, just having that interaction.
In Tennessee, residents took advantage of this weekend's partial reopening of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. And in Ocean City, Maryland, the chilly temperatures didn't deter dozens of people from lining up for boardwalk treats at the reopened beaches. Danya Bacchus, CBS News, Los Angeles.
Governor Cuomo says the CDC has asked New York to develop national criteria for the mysterious illness affecting children. Following a special called meeting this afternoon, Columbus Mayor Robert Smith announces a revision to the city's previous decision to keep barbershops, nail salons, and gyms closed despite the governor's executive order allowing them to reopen. As of Monday, May 11th, all Columbus barbers, beauty shops, nail salons, gyms, fitness centers, tattoo parlors, tanning salons, and spas can reopen. The governor's executive order 1480 authorizes these businesses to reopen, but they are not required to reopen. Smith and the Restart Columbus committees met and went over the details of the order. And for a full look at that order, you can visit our website, WCBI.com. Starkville city leaders are following the governor's lead in restarting the state's economy. At a special called meeting today, aldermen voted to allow some businesses, including hair salons and nail salons, barbershops and gyms, to reopen. Shop owners will have to take some extra steps, including deep cleaning and sanitization, before they can welcome clients back.
We felt like it was appropriate for us to adopt what the governor was doing, because if we were to try to call out businesses different than the governor, then it looks as though we're picking and choosing who it is we're going to require to have extra requirements on them in ways that might be considered impeding their business. And so that was part of the concern.
The next regular meeting of the mayor and board of aldermen will be May 19th.
A picture-perfect sunset out there this evening. Take a look at this view from Columbus, sent in to us by Satoya on Facebook. Just a beautiful view, but it didn't make up for the cold temperatures we had today. A lot of us stayed in the 60s, and with a little bit of a wind, it was a little bit chilly at times, especially for the month of May. But as of tonight, it's going to be even colder. 39 for the low, a mostly clear sky and a calm wind also means a little bit of patchy frost certainly possible, especially along the Tennessee border up to the north of I-22. Mother's Day, though, looking fantastic. Just a little bit warmer. Still not where we should be for this time of year, but we'll hit 74 in Columbus, 73 in Calhoun City. We have about the same in Starkville, 73 there, and 73 in Eupora as well. Plenty of sunshine and blue sky, but there are some increasing rain chances in the forecast. I'll tell you when we can expect that coming up in just a little bit. Cash.
Thanks, Trevor. Well, take a look at this. The Columbus Air Force Base held a flyover for healthcare workers and others who are on the front lines of the COVID-19 pandemic. The flight pattern started at the Air Force Base at around 1:45 and made passes through Tupelo, Amory, Aberdeen, West Point, Starkville, and finished in Columbus, where aircrafts flew over Baptist Memorial Hospital. Well, for the first time in a long time, the Columbus Farmers Market, that is, was back up and running. The market was held from 7 to 10 this morning, and vendors sold fresh produce and homemade treats. But it wasn't exactly business as usual. Both vendors and shoppers had to abide by social distancing guidelines.
You know, we really want to support our local farmers and our local economy, but of course the safety precautions are a big thing, so we want everybody to be safe and to shop safely. You know, some masks and gloves are required, but there's plenty of produce to choose from. We've got all the vendors facing out into the parking lot so that people can maintain the proper 6 feet apart, and we've had a really good response this morning.
For a list of times for the market, you can visit our website, WCBI.com. COVID-19 is having an impact in almost every area of our society. Even our four-legged friends are being affected. And this is normally one of the busiest times of year for animal shelters. But with new restrictions in place, they're having to change the way they operate. Our Savannah Gato has more on how one area shelter is coping.
So OCHS has implemented several precautions in order to protect the health and safety of our staff and the animals that are in our care. We have about 145 animals in our care, about 80 at the shelter itself, and about 60 in foster homes.
Coronavirus has forced the Oktibbeha County Humane Society to change the way it operates.
Starting back in March, we held an adoption special and pushed fosters, trying to get as many animals out of the shelter as possible. March 15th is when we locked our doors. However, we're still open to visitors, just by appointment only.
The appointment only policy is just one of the changes. Everyone that enters the animal shelter is required to wear a mask, including the staff.
Their safety is paramount, and in order for our animals to be well cared for and provided for, our staff need to be healthy and safe.
According to Thomas, the animal shelter has had a 22% decrease in animal intake. That's the good news. The bad news is there has also been a 38% decrease in adoptions.
We are concerned that with that 22% decrease in the number of intakes for that period, we're concerned about those animals. And are they out in the community? Are they going to come in a flood once our doors are unlocked and we're open regular hours? We're not sure, but we're doing the best we can to care for the animals in our care and continue to serve the community.
The Humane Society has a special adoption event to help free up space in case that happens.
Starting today, Saturday, May 9th through May 17th, thanks to Bissell Pet Foundation, we're running the Empty the Shelters event where all adoptable pets are $25.
Every adoptable pet is spayed, neutered, and microchipped and up to date on vaccinations.
If you're interested in adopting or fostering, you can visit the Oktibbeha County Humane Society's website to see which animals are available. Graduation for the class of 2020 was anything but traditional. More on area celebrations when we come back.
10 p.m. with Cash Matlock.
Welcome back, everyone. Today in Aberdeen, citizens came together to celebrate the class of 2020. Family and friends all met at City Hall with one thing in mind: honoring those seniors. Honorees received balloons, proclamations, and even a few scholarships.
Back in October, we decided to come together and make a decision on how we was gonna give back to our community. And this was one of the things that we came up with, to give our scholarships to the seniors.
We will hear more from Aberdeen seniors and parents Sunday night at 9 and 10. For more than 5,000 Ole Miss graduates, this is the day they've been working toward for years. But as our own graduate DeAndrea Turner finds, this year's graduation is far from the traditional pomp and circumstance.
It's graduation day at Ole Miss, but Madison Scarpino isn't headed to the Grove. She's headed to her living room. Her college days are turning into memories with a virtual graduation ceremony. Scarpino and her roommate dressed up and booted up the computer to join the live stream. For her, the graduation experience was untraditional and a little surreal.
Happening right now. It was just crazy to me that was our graduation ceremony.
But with music, friends, and cheers to a new beginning, she made the best out of it.
Like I said, I think that they did a nice job of using the tools that they could to put something good together for us. I love how they had some celebrities in there.
And she looks forward to what's next.
I am definitely excited for that next chapter of my life.
Ole Miss says that the virtual ceremony is not a replacement of the one in person.
Well, the Lowndes County Courthouse certainly looking nice on this chilly Saturday evening, and it's going to get even cooler from here. I'll tell you exactly how low we're going to get coming up right after this in my First Alert forecast.
First Alert AccuWeather forecast with meteorologist Trevor Burchett.
Certainly a chillier than normal day for the first week of May, and we're going to be even colder tonight. In fact, we might even break some record lows, getting down into the 30s overnight. Mother's Day certainly looking nice, though. It'll be a great day to get outside and enjoy some outdoor activities with Mom. What's coming up, though, is a warming trend, getting back to above average temperatures by the end of the week, and also the chance for a couple of isolated showers as we get into the middle and end portion of the week. We'll talk about that coming up in a little bit. First, let's go back to where we were today. Our high temperature today in Columbus, 67 degrees, 67 in Tupelo as well. Where we should be this time of year is 80. So we are about 13 or 15 degrees below where we normally are. That's courtesy of that cold front that came through about 24 hours ago. And we're actually going to have another cold front come through that could take us even back to where we were today as we get closer to Monday. However, we're going to have to talk about another dip in the temperatures. You can see here 69 for Monday, warming up by the middle and end of the week. Like I said, we should be at 80. We'll be there for Wednesday, and then we go above average for the end of the week and as we get into the weekend. For today on the Off Insurance Camera Network time lapse, take a look at this. Plenty of blue sky and sunshine all across the area. You see the traffic down there on Main Street in downtown Tupelo, the sun setting behind the tree at Durham's Pharmacy. All of those good views courtesy of high pressure over in eastern Tennessee, and that's basically set up a dome across the southeastern United States. No weather can develop anywhere around the high pressure, hardly even any clouds, but we did have a few clouds out there today, and as a matter of fact, we've got just a few high clouds out there right now. You see along and south of Highway 82. Most of us will remain clear tonight, and I think even what cloud cover is here now will exit the area as we get closer to midnight. Here's a look at hour by hour. We're in the 50s right now, but we are going to dip quickly with the calm winds and the clear skies. We are actually going to end up in the upper 30s in a lot of areas by the time you wake up tomorrow morning. 39 for the low here in Columbus, 38 possibly in West Point, and some spots up to the north along the Tennessee border could even see a little bit of patchy frost. And as a matter of fact, we also have the potential to break a couple of record lows. As I mentioned, 39 is the forecast. The last time we were this cold or anywhere close to it in Columbus was 40. And that was back in 1906. So over 100 years ago was the last time we hit 40 degrees on this date in Columbus. And if we get below that, if we hit 39 like we're forecasting, we'll break a record low temperature that was set over 100 years ago in the Golden Triangle. Tomorrow, a little bit warmer than we were today. We'll get up to 74 under a mostly clear sky, just a light westerly wind. Overall, a really nice day for Mom and a really nice next several days. We'll have some clouds building here by the beginning of the week. And then we've got to talk about the slight chance for a couple of rain chances as we get toward the middle and end of the week. That courtesy of this low pressure system coming out of the Plain States by Tuesday, it gets a little closer to us and it really sets up shop just to the north of us. And that low pressure bringing in a little bit of moisture could prompt a few isolated showers, maybe even a rumble of thunder on Wednesday. I don't think everybody sees rain, but it's certainly possible. We're going to throw in the chance anytime after Tuesday for the end of the week and into the weekend, an isolated shower possible. Best chances are Wednesday and Friday, but still a few showers possible. Highs getting back into the mid-80s by the end of the week. We're back with more after this. Stay with us.
Welcome back in, everyone. Due to the nature of our times, a traditional event in Tupelo was canceled this year. WCBI's Chad Groening reports on how the city came up with an alternative.
Tupelo Parks and Recreation Director Alex Farnett and his crew were busy making duty burgers, the local favorite served at iconic Duty's Diner for decades. This weekend would have seen a large crowd celebrating the annual Duty Burger Festival. But thanks to the coronavirus, this year's event became a Duty Burgers drive-by, where folks could come and pick up a bagged meal, including two Duty Burgers.
We have just been so blessed that we're going to be able to have this Duty Burger Festival today. Even though we're kind of minus the festival, we really wanted to contribute and give back during this pandemic by doing some burgers and doing it safely and doing it through a drive-thru and trying to still, keep the history of the Duty Burger Diner alive.
It's a piece of Tupelo history, and we want everybody to remember Christian Truman Duty and the good times that were had when he brought the streetcar down in the 30s, made his famous dough burger, the Duty's Burger.
As you can see, vehicles are backed up as folks are coming here to the parking lot of the Orrin Dunn Museum to take part in this rather unique Duty Burger drive-by event, which is the largest fundraiser of the year for the Orrin Dunn Museum. And the event was quite well received.
Oh my stars, we've waited all year long for this because we used to go to Duty's when it was downtown by Crosstown. Y'all are angels. Y'all are hamburger angels.
It's all right. Just wish everything was opened up. Glad to be out by the house a little bit.
Oh, I think it's wonderful. It brings back family memories of my parents sitting in the parking lot eating hamburgers back in the 60s. It's just it's just a wonderful event that we can still experience it, and our son is home and he can experience it, and it's just like a hamburger like no other.
I don't think Duty's was around in my lifetime, but I've heard Mom talk about it for years and how they'd come to town, and if they weren't eating at Johnny's, then they'd be going up to Duty's.
We would much rather have got to go in and see the museum and the old Duty's hamburger hut and everything. We'd rather have done it differently, for sure.
Yeah, it's different, and we're just being safe, though, to protect ourselves since we are older. And I wish it was the other way, that we could be out in public, but we have to do what we have to do to be safe.
Chad Groening, WCBI News, Tupelo.
They hope to raise $6,000 at this weekend's event. When we come back, we say goodbye to a legend. Little Richard died in Nashville today. The flamboyant wild man of rock and roll was 87. The cause, cancer. Today, the marquee at Harlem's Apollo Theater paid tribute to Richard. It was a place he knew well. CBS's Michael George has more.
Little Richard, born Richard Penniman in Macon, Georgia in 1932, was one of the founding fathers of rock and roll. His music, a glorious mix of boogie, gospel, and blues, combining a sky-high pompadour and garish stage makeup with joyful, over-the-top performances. Everyone from Elton John to Prince counted him as a defining influence.
Little Richard sold out the Apollo Theater nearly a dozen times at the height of his career in the mid-50s.
But in 1957, he walked away from show business to become a preacher. He returned in the 60s, performing sold-out shows for decades, named to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in its first class in 1986. Little Richard was 87 years old. Michael George, CBS News, New York.
Happy early Mother's Day to all you mothers out there. 74 for tomorrow. Plenty of sunshine and blue sky. Perfect day to get outside and enjoy the weather. And really, the next few days going to be nice. Clouds will build in as we get into Tuesday. You see the mix of sun and clouds. We'll be back into the mid-70s then. We've got some isolated chances for a stray shower, maybe a rumble of thunder through the end of the week. I think most of us really stay dry, though, for the next 7 days. forecast. Check out those temperatures, though. Back into the mid-80s by Thursday and into the weekend. So we go from below-average temperatures to above-average temperatures. A little bit of something for everybody, I guess.
Yeah, Trevor, I'm so upset I can't spend tomorrow with my mom.
I know,
it's perfect
me too.
Weather.
I know.
All right, well, thank you guys for watching. We'll see you back here tomorrow.